Good evening, students. On behalf of Reda Academy, I welcome you all for the economics class. So today I am going to start with the introduction to microeconomics, same chapter 1. This will be the fourth session, and today I am going to cover the following contents. One is its methods, facts, theories and laws of economics. So the first methods of economics, under the methods of economics, we are going to see deductive and inductive method. So these two methods, it's very very important to analyze the and for the study of economics. So first we'll see the deduction method. So deduction method, this method, it is also known as analytical or abstract method. And this analytical and abstract method, it's like from the general truth and general principles, the economist, they draw some conclusions for the economic facts with the help of some economic indicators. So here this deduction method, the classical and neoclassical school of economist, like for example Ricardo, J.S. Mill, Malthus, Marshall, Pigou, all this economist, they uses this deductive method for the some of the economic investigations. Okay, and there are some steps to be followed for the deductive method. One is whoever is doing the research in the economic field, they have to be very clear and they have to be very precise in the ideas of some of ideas of the economic problems. Okay, then only this method it can be applicable. And after this, the second step will be the researcher or the analyst, they should be very clear in the technical terms which is used in the analysis. So this terms, it will be from the assumptions of the theory. And also they have to, the third step is they have to frame the hypothesis from the assumptions what they are framing. And finally, the verification of the hypothesis, it will be taken place. Like for example, whether there exists any inverse relationship between price and quantity demanded. The best example is to find out the difference or the relationship between the price and quantity demanded for a particular commodity. This deductive method, it's very very useful, and this are all the following steps has to be followed. The next one is inductive method. So this deductive method is different and inductive method is different. Deductive method, theoretically it will be framed the finding the solution for the economic problems, theoretical basis it will go on. Whereas in the inductive method, it's called as empirical method. With the help of the data, with the help of the scientific methods, there will be a solution. We will find out the solution for the economic problem. So that's why we call it as a inductive method. So two types of methods it will be there to analyze the solution for the economic facts. So it is adapted by the historical school of economics. So here, how this inductive method, it will be based on experimentations, observations and statistical methods. So whenever you want to find out a solution for an economic problem, like finding out the birth rate, finding out the price level, finding out the consumption level, all those things, we will collect the data with the help of the numbers. Will find out the solution for the economic problem. So this kind of method, we call it as inductive method. And even in inductive method, there are some steps to be followed. Step one is data collection. So data will be collected, and after collecting the data, it has to be arranged properly. You might be studied in statistics, statistical, mathematical students will study, statistical students will study the problems. So, finding, collecting the data and consolidating the data, arranging the data and getting the solution for that. So, once the data is collected, the solutions or the conclusions, it will be drawn easily. And how this solution will be happen, it will be depending upon the hypothesis formulation. So you have to frame the hypothesis. Those who want to know the facts and solution for a problem, they have to collect the data and they have to frame the hypothesis. Formulation should be there. Whether it's a hypothesis formulation, it is nothing but the assumptions, whether the result, it will be go to a positive level or negative level. It's an assumption. So sometimes this assumption, it may be a positive one or it may not be. On the two part, the things will happen. So once after collecting the data, the conclusion will be obtained by framing the hypothesis test. So after that, the final step is the verification of the hypothesis. For example, Engel's law. Engel's law, it is nothing but here you see the proportion of total expenditure incurred on food items declines as total expenditure goes on increasing. So this Engel's law, it says that the expenditure incurred on a particular food items, it may decline when the total expenditure goes on increasing. Sometimes this also will happen and vice versa also will happen. And here this economists, they say this method, they are complementary actually. So here you see, this is one of the important thing under the inductive method. And here both inductive and deductive method, it's very very essential in the field of economics, because like a scientific thought, because the economic facts, it cannot be analyzed only theoretically, it has to be proved empirically. So Alfred Marshall, he says that both deductive method and inductive method, it is very very essential to know the economic facts in a country which has a very good structure. So here, like a scientific scientific thought, both inductive and deductive method, and this will be very easy for you when you study both the inductive method and deductive method in a practical way. So in the coming chapters, we will study all the inductive and deductive method. The next, we are going to see some of the facts and theories. So facts, some facts like changes in the prices of the commodity. So here, using this inductive method and deductive method, we will study some of the changes in the price of a commodity. So here, this changes in the price of a commodity can be studied either with the inductive method or with the deductive method. And similarly, the quantity demanded for that particular commodity, not only the price of a commodity, these facts will be studied with the inductive and deductive method, that is the demand for a commodity. And also the theory, theory of the demand. So the theory of the demand also will study in economics. Yes. So that is when the what is the theory of demand? It is nothing but whenever there is a changes in the price, the quantity of the commodity also, it will have some changes, whether it increases or decreases. So like for example, you take, if one price of a pen is 10 rupees, what will be the quantity demanded among the students in a particular area? If the prices decreases for the same particular commodity, if the price of the pen decreases, how the demand will be? Whether it will be increasing or decreasing? Obviously, if the price decreases, the quantity demanded, it will be increasing. When the price of the same commodity, when the price of pen increases, the quantity demanded, it will be decreasing. So the changes in the price, or the increase or decrease in the price level of a commodity, will lead to the demand for the commodity, whether it decreases or increases. So this kind of activity we'll study in the in our subject. So that's why we call it as a theory of demand. So all these things will be it will be studied in the these are all the facts, actually these are all the natural facts which we see in our day-to-day life. So this kind of facts we study in economics. And not only that, we study some of the theories of law actually. So this theory of law, it is nothing but, here you see some statements of tendencies we study in economics. So that's why Marshall, he says that economic laws are statement of tendencies. So this law of, why we say that it's an economic class, because we through the subject we study some of the cause and effect. So because of what this happens, because of what price increases, because of what reason the price it's going on increasing, and because of what reason that quantity it demanded it decreases, or because of what fact the quantity demanded it keep on increasing, all those things, changes, fluctuations in the economy, it happens, we study in economics. And also here it cannot be compared, this law of there are no laws of economics which can be compared for precision with the law of gravitation. So here the laws, it cannot be compared with the other science subjects, this economics. And here now we are going to see some of the importance of microeconomics. So microeconomics, already we have seen what is microeconomics. It is the study of an individual, the economic activity, I told you in the first session itself. So here, what is the importance of micro? What is the importance of microeconomics? There are n number of importance in the study of microeconomics. The main important things I have listed. The first one, it is used to study the operation of an economy. So the studying the economics at an individual level, it is used to understand, it is very much helpful to understand the operation of how the micro level economic facts it happens in an economy. So that's what, it's very very important. And also it provides the tool for economic policies. So this micro study or small level of study, it is used to find out what are all the problems which is existing in an economy, and to solve the problem it is used to frame the economic policies. So that's why we say that importance of microeconomics is to provide the tools for the economic policies, like agricultural policy, like educational policy, health policies, and etc. etc. So many policies will be there. The next, it is used to examine the conditions of economic welfare. So focusing particularly on particular people in an economy will lead to find out the problem and get the solution for the problem. So once the solution is obtained, automatically the welfare of the economy will arise. So this is the main importance. The next, it is used to find out the efficient utilization of resources. So efficient utilization of resources, whether the people are utilizing the resources or whether the government is utilizing the human resources. So we know what are all the types of resources which is available in our country. So natural resources, we have abundant of natural resources, forest resources, we have water resources, we have around the country on the three sides of our country. We have the coal, all the steels, all those resources are available, but how far the people and government, they are utilizing the resources. So this microeconomics, it is used to analyze the efficient utilization of all those resources. Then it is used to study the international trade. You know, trade, it is what do you mean by trade? The process of importing and exporting the commodities. And international trade, after globalization, our country, it's very good in doing the international trade, exporting the commodities to the other countries, importing the commodities to our country. So exporting, we are exporting so much of agricultural commodities, we are importing more of industrial commodities from the other countries. So this microeconomics, it is used in the process of this import and export of commodities. Okay, and also it is used in making decision making. So this decision making by an individual and by the state, by the central government. So we can analyze the decision making of all the people around the all the people with the help of microeconomics. It is used to find out the decision making of an individual and group of people and even the government. The next one is optimal resource allocation. How far the resources it is allocated, it can be studied through microeconomics. So this allocation means, like for example, you see how far the educational facilities it is allocated to the rural people, the people, those who are living in the backward area. So likewise, all this facts can be studied in microeconomics. And not only that, it is microeconomics, it is used to do the prediction. It's nothing but forecasting how far in future it will happen, whatever the economic facts, how the price level it will be in the next week, how the price level of potato, tomato, all the necessary commodities, day-to-day commodities, how it will be. Like for example, if it is this week, it's we are having a very heavy rainfall, what will be the price of this vegetables in the next week? We can predict through analyzing the some of the indicators, which we call it as the study of microeconomics. And not only that, as I told you, price determination, how if that in that case how the future price of the commodity it will be, whether to the farmers, they will decide if it is raining, how they will decide how to fix the price for the commodity. So if it is a heavy rainfall comes, then what will happen? They will increase the price level of the tomato, they will increase the price level of the onion. Likewise, and also they determine the price level. So homogeneous producers, they'll come together, they will fix the price for the commodity. If suppose the demand it goes down, what will happen? At that time also they determine the price level. And not only for the agricultural products, even for the other manufacturing commodities also. So determining the price. So this determination of price in detail we'll study in the coming chapters. And also here you see this micro, it's not very as I told you, the importance of microeconomics, there are so many importance, and changes in economic science cannot be brought about easily. As a result, prediction regarding human behavior is likely to go wrong. As I told you, see, in this in all these points we have seen the importance of microeconomics, where the facts will be real, but there are some facts which will not be easy to calculate. Actually, sometimes it may go wrong also, like for example regarding predicting the human behavior. So human behavior, there are exceptions to the law of demand, like economic laws are not invoidable. That is, here we cannot predict. If I am a consumer, sometimes I will be very much tempted to consume a commodity. If I don't have money, I will never bother about to going to shopping. So in that case my behavior will change. I am a consumer, you are a consumer, even the producers also will be the consumer of their manufacturing commodities, spare parts, okay. So in that case, each and every one, we are the consumers. So our behavior, it will change. It will not remain constant all the time period. So our behavior will keep on changing according to our needs, according to our time period, according to our income. It keep on changing. So at that time we cannot say that the prediction it will go correctly all the time. Sometimes it go wrong also. So that's why we call that economic loss. It is not invoidable. Okay, and he Marshall, he says that he compares this with the loss of tides. That is a human behavior is volatile, and economic laws are not assertive, but they are indicative. Like for example, you see, there will be a it's not very easy. Like for example, you take the demand concept itself. So you see the demand, for example, if to analyze the demand condition of a particular commodity, we cannot say that only price alone will determine the demand for the commodity. It's not like that. The other factors also is there where it influence the demand for a commodity. Like for example, you take a handbag. So if I like the handbag, I will, have the money with me, then I will be tempted to purchase the commodity. So how I will have the money in my hand? One thing is, it depends upon my income. Though if I have the money with me, the other factors also, it will influence the demand for a particular commodity. So here we cannot say that only one factor will influence the demand for a commodity. Even the other factors also it will influence. Like for example, if I don't want to purchase the commodity, that means if I have more options already, I may be having the same commodity maybe with different designs and colors at my home. So that we cannot say that only income will influence. My other behavior also, it will lead to the changes in the demand for a commodity. or otherwise I may not have more money in my hand. So at that time I may not go for that particular commodity, to purchase the particular commodity. We can say some other examples also. Like, for example, you see the woolen cloths and cotton cloths. So here the woolen cloths and cotton cloths, it not only price, it determines the demand for the commodity. The climate also, it determines the demand for the commodity. The people, those who are living in the very chill climate, they have to consume the woolen cloths. The people, those who are living in the very hot climate, hot region, they will go for a cotton cloths. And now, as I told you, the demand for a particular commodity, not only price determines the demand, even the climate, determines even the taste and preference of the customers also. Taste and preference also, it determines the demand. And the other psychological behavior of the consumer also, it determines the demand for the commodity. So that's why we say this economics, it not only predicts the results for the facts, this economic law, we say that it is indicative. They are not assertive, but they are indicative. Sometimes the analysis of the indicators, it may go wrong also. Best example is the behavior, consumer behavior in purchasing a commodity. And here, some economic laws are simply, they are truism. Like, for example, you see, savings is a function of income. So only we have more income, we will be having savings. People now in India, they don't have proper employment. As there is no proper employment, no income. As there is no income, no expenditure, then how come the savings will come? But the common fact is, savings is a function of income. So that is very true. We agree with that also. That's why we say some of the economic laws, that is mainly the savings is a function of income, it's very true actually. So that's why we call this economic law. Sometimes it's true. And one more example is, human wants are unlimited. So that also we have to agree. So we agree this economic law, it's true. And now we are going to see some of the subdivisions of economics. One is consumption, production, exchange, distribution. Already we have, by this name itself, you can easily understand what is consumption. Consumption, it is nothing but the human wants. So human wants is the starting point of the economic activity. So whenever there is human wants, obviously the activity will happen. So if you want, then you have to purchase the commodity. When you purchase the commodity, you will get satisfaction, you will get utility level, and the analysis of utility and the price of the commodity, study about the wants, whatever the wants, the commodities which we use in our daily life. So the price of the commodity, the production of the commodity, and distribution of the commodity, how the price is, they are fixing the price for the commodity, how they are distributing, all this economic activity we need to know. So consumption, it is nothing but the consuming the process of buying the commodity. So that is the basic point of economic activity we know. The second one is production. So production, it is nothing but the process of transformation of inputs into outputs, that is unfinished goods into the finished goods. Okay, then exchange. So here exchange, it is nothing but the price determination in different market forms. How it is, how the finished commodity determined with the price. And finally, distribution. Distribution, it is nothing but once the commodity it is produced in a manufacturing sector with the factors of production like land, labor, capital and organization, it has to be distributed to the people in a place in and around the manufacturing sector. Some commodities it will be distributed in the local market, some commodities it will be distributed in the common market, some it will be outside the state, and a few commodities it is outside the, it is distributed or we can say exported to the other countries which we study in the international trade. So here distribution, it is nothing but whatever the commodity which is produced by the producer in a country, it has to be sold out, and the selling, it needs some place, it needs some markets, whether it is a local market or national market or international market. Okay, so these are all the subdivisions of economics. The next is, we are going, as already we have seen the two types of micro and economics, one is micro and macro. In the first session itself I told you there are two types of economics, one is microeconomics and macroeconomics. So I hope you remember, micro, it is nothing but a small study of small economic activities. Macro economics, macro means large, or we can say aggregate, study of larger level of economic activities or group of economic activities, we can say. See here, microeconomics, it is nothing but economic decision making of an individual, like how the producer, how a producer is producing the commodity, what kind of factors of production he is utilizing in the manufacturing sector. Then how the consumer, what kind of consumers the producer, particular producer, he is having in his sector. Okay, so which we call it as microeconomics. Macroeconomics, it is nothing but the aggregate and average of entire economy. So how the total output of a like for example, you take textile industries, what is the total output of the textile industries in the current year? Then what is the national income of our country in a year? Or we can study the comparison of the national income for the years. Then savings, likewise savings and investment. What is the total savings of the people? What is the total investment? So this total or aggregate of aggregate we study, aggregate of the economic facts, we call it as macro. The next here, small components of the whole economy. As I told you, a part or the portion of the economic study of the portion of an economic facts is called microeconomics. Then here, the macroeconomics, the it comes to an account of all the economy as a whole. Then here it deals with the process of price determination. So price determine, how the price it is determining a particular person. Okay, and here under macroeconomics we study the general price level in an economy. What is the general price level? Okay, for whatever the commodity is, like petrol, diesel, whatever it is. Okay, so the next, it is known as price theory. Yes. See, under microeconomics, we study some of the economic facts as a theory, like price theory. So we have so much of economic facts. The main important thing is price and demand. So the next here, income theory. Under macroeconomics, we study the income theory. And how the theory will be, who formulated the theory, and how, what is the formula, all those things we will study in the coming chapters. Then here, microeconomics, it deals with the individual consumer and producer. you know, how the individual, how my income, it determines the how the price increase determines my consumption level in purchasing the bag. So we study under microeconomics in this way. Then growth process of the entire economy. Yes, under macroeconomics we study each and every economic facts as a whole. The growth process of the entire economy will be obtained by studying the macroeconomics. Apart from those, we have some of the subdivisions of economics. One is international economics. International economics, as I told you, after globalization, India, it become a very popular country, and we are exporting so many commodities to the other countries, mainly the agricultural country, because most of the people in India, they depend upon the agriculture. And what are all the main commodities we are, the excess amount of commodity, it is exported to the other country. And coffee, tea, cardamom, then cotton, jute, all those commodities, we have plenty of those commodities, and only the plenty of commodities can be exported to the other countries to earn more income. So under international trade we will study all those things, whereas when compared to the agricultural commodities, manufacturing commodities, we are exporting very less. And compared to the export, we are importing more and more of commodities. That's why we don't have proper process in the balance of payments. And not only that, under international economics, we study foreign capital. Then investment, foreign direct investment, FDI, VCM in short. So this all this kind of commodities transaction and the foreign capital out of the transaction, all those things we'll study under the international economics, which comes under the economics. Okay, the next second one is public economics or public finance. So public finance, it is nothing but how in the local level or in the state level and in the national level, even in the international level also, we study how a country, how our country, they are having the public income, actually how the state income is, how the national income is, and how the expenditure, national expenditure, public revenue. I told you already what is expenditure, revenue, debt. Revenue, it is nothing but the income, how the government, they are getting the income, what are all the debt, how much debt they are having. So each and every year the finance minister of the central and state government, they used to produce budget presentation. So they release the budget. So in that budget, there will the all the details, it will be available. That is public expenditure, public revenue, public debt, financial administration, and federal finance. What is the purpose of releasing the budget every year? So to maintain the economy in a proper level. Okay, so if you take in your home, your father and mother, they will be earning, and with that help of the monthly income, they used to do a budget. What is the income and what are all the things they have to spend the money for, your food, for your rent, or for your for other purposes, like financial purpose, they have to pay fees to your schools. So and if there is any deficit, there will be a debt, automatically debt will arise. So if in that case, how to manage the debt, all those things, they'll sit together and they'll do the calculations, which we call it as what, the budgeting a household. Okay, that's why we see in the initial session itself the meaning of economics. Okay, so I in that session I maybe told you what is the total, the complete meaning of economics. Okay, so in that case, which we call it as the financial administration, how the your parents, they are doing the administration in getting the income and doing the expenditure. okay, so to run your family. So in that way, our state government and central government, they do budgeting, which includes the public expenditure, public income, public debt, financial administration, federal finance. Okay, so all those things only in economics we study. Okay, then next, developmental economy, economics. So developmental economics, it is nothing but we study in economics, we study how the development of the people and development of the country is occurring, how the development of a country is. So development of an individual, how we analyze with the help of the per capita income, because only per capita income will lead to the development of a standard of development of a individual person and as a whole the human development index also, and even the happiness index also. So this HDI, it will be done by the other countries also. So so with that we'll see under the HDI, we can see at which place our country it is. Okay, so all those things we study under economics. And what are why, like for example, if you go to the human development index, you can find out in among the countries in the world, India at which place it is, and with the help of the number you can identify the, you can see the difference between each countries, and if it is not up to the mark, you can come to a conclusion that whether our country is a developed nation or developing, because there are so many obstacles for the development of a country. Okay, like in influencing, some factors will be there which influence the development and non-development. Some models will be there which cannot be followed, like growth models and strategies. Okay, so in that case, by analyzing, by seeing all those facts, you will come to a conclusion whether the people in a country and the whole country, whether it is it got development or not. So so analyzing all these facts for a particular development, we call those things as a developmental economics. The next one is health economics. Yes, even in economics we used to study and we used to find out the we used to compare economics with the health also. And like for example, here you see preventive and curative measures, medical research, education, rural health mission, then drug price control, neonatal care, maternity, child health, budgetary allocation for health. So these are all the things we study under health economics, that is finding the relationship between the health as well as the economics. So how the expenditure, it happens. See here, under the in the budget presentation, the finance minister also, they, he will be, the government also, they will be allotting the money for the health sector, for the childbirth, for the old age people, what are all the schemes they have brought. So all those things, we scheme studying of the budget allocation, expenditure, then administrating the budget in the health sector, then number of birth, number of death, then studying about the, but all these things, it is related with economics. We cannot say that, we cannot separate health and economics. It is related to each other very closely actually. Okay, so that's why this health economics is also a part of economics. Okay, the next, finally, environmental economics. Environmental economics also, environment also, it is closely related with economics. And this environment, it can, it's studied under economics, we study the how the pollution it is affected. For example, I am telling you how the people they are affected out of the pollution. So collecting the data of those people, consolidating the data, finding out the framing the hypothesis, finding out the solution for the problem, and this solution it is used to frame some of the economic policies to implement and correct the problem in the economy. So that's why I told you in the facts, some of the facts and laws, the steps of doing, how to do the steps, how to do a research, to find out the solution for a problem. So in that way, environmental economics is also one of the subdivision of economics, where environment and economics, it is related to each other very closely. I think you have understood. That is, environment is closely related with economics, because the study, some of the indicators of economics, it is related with the environment, and this the problem in the environment, like what are the problems which we have today. We have problem on the problem of pollution, air pollution, water pollution, so many noise pollutions. Okay, so in order to find out the solution for all those problems, the government, they take the measures, to control the problem in the environment. So how they do the process of finding out the solution through economics. Okay, so environmental economics, it's very very important, is also one of the important subdivisions of economics. So there are so many people, those who are doing their health economics and environmental economics in their higher studies. Okay, those people, those who are studying public economics in depth, they are choosing their higher studies. They choose public economics in their higher studies, and they are going as a finance minister to help the management of a state government and central government. There are so many people, n number of people, those who are very much interested in the development of a individual and development of a country. They do go for a social welfare, to do social welfare, so which we study under the development economics. The next, the basic economic problems of a country. Already I have discussed this thing in the first session itself, that is the basic problems. We know the wants, we have discussed the wants, desires, unlimited, the scarce resources which is freely available in a country, how the people, they are not using the available resources to avoid the scarcity, and the choices, all those things we have seen. And there are four important main problem which the people we have in a developing country like India. That is, the first thing is what and how much to produce. So the producers, we have more of producers in the all the three sectors. So we have, like for example, how to, whether to produce more food, more cloth, housing, and to have more luxurious goods. So people, they, the producers, they will be having the confusion to produce the food, because production of more goods of all this basic commodities, some area it will work out, but in some area it will not work out. Okay, so at that time what happens, no, the producer cannot sell the commodity which is produced by him. So at that time the producer will not have the proper knowledge what to produce the commodity. Like for example, you take Tamil Nadu. In Tamil Nadu, the producer, if they are producing more of woolen cloths instead of cotton cloths, what will happen? The consumption level will decrease for the woolen cloths. they have to produce whenever it is necessary, not all the months in a year. Okay, so that complete knowledge should be there for the producer. So that's why the problem, as they don't have, there arises the problem for a problem in an economy. And even whether the producer has to produce more agricultural goods or to industrial goods or services. If you take India is a agricultural country. More of people, they depend upon agriculture. They know only agricultural production, because most of the people, they are not educated, they are into agricultural, because the geographical area, we have more of agricultural lands, and people, they depend more on when compared to the industrial and service sectors, more of agriculture, more than 60% of the people, they depend upon agriculture. So these are all the situations, and the producer, they has to produce more agricultural goods with available resources, natural resources. If they are going for producing the other products in the other sectors, what will happen? That will not match the people, those who are living in our country. We need more of agricultural commodities because we have more of population. So in a country like India, it is a densely populated country, we need to increase the agricultural production. So instead, if the producer is going for the other service sector, then it will not match, then the sector economy will have a deficit in the in those particular food commodities. So this is also one of the problem, what and how much to produce, how much the agricultural commodities has to be produced, it has to be, how much industrial and service sector has to be, it has to be produced in that way, according to the need of the people. The next one is use more resources in education and health, or to use more resources in military services. Yes, our country, they spend lot of money, more amount of money on the military services, and they spend, some of the states, they spend lot of money for the education and health, like Tamil Nadu, Kerala, then some other states in the northeast, they are very good in utilizing the resources in education and health. That's why we have good education and health basic education and higher education also. Whereas if you take some other states like Bihar, Rajasthan, these are all the states where the government, state government, they spend less amount of money in education and health. That's why they are not having any development at all, development of the people, development of the state. Okay, so there arises a lack in the what and how much to produce. The next, the consumption goods ought to have investment goods. So consumption goods and investment goods, this also it's a very big question mark in our country. The consumption and investment goods, it differs in different states, but both consumption and investment goods should be there. But this is according to the people's ability, according to their income, the consumption and investment, it differs actually. But as a whole, we don't have a proper, our country, it does not have any, the producers, they don't have the proper knowledge whether to produce more consumption goods or not. And as I told you earlier, the producers, they don't know how much to spend on basic education or higher education. If you take Kerala, in Kerala basic education will be very good. If you take Tamil Nadu, higher education, it will be very good. So both Kerala and Tamil Nadu, they will be placing first place and second place often in the ranking towards the basic education or higher education. Okay, but whereas if you see the other states, it will not be like that. Okay, because they don't have the much knowledge how much to and what to produce in their states. The next one is how to produce. they have to decide what to produce, then how to produce the commodity. How means whether the producer, they have to follow labor intensive technology or capital intensive technology. Labor, it is nothing but producing the commodity with the help of more labors. Capital intensive, it is nothing but with the help of machines, production with the help of the machines. So here in our country, the producers, they don't have the complete knowledge to produce the commodity, whether with the help of the labors or with the help of the capital. And so this is the main problem which arises in a developing country like India. The next, for whom to produce, this is very very important. For whom to produce? So whether rich commodity is produced and it has to be sold to the poor people? No, it is not like that. The producer has to decide in a particular area what kind of people they are living. If I want to start a production process in a particular area, I have to, before starting the production, I have to complete, I have to do a research what kind of area it is. What kind of consumer are there? Whether they are highly income people or medium income people or poor people. Whether my production it will be accepted by the people living there or not. Okay, all those kind of research I have to do before producing the commodity. If not, what will happen in the distribution of the commodity? There will be a problem will arise. Okay, so that has to be looked into, because that is a very important basic problem which we found in our country. And the problem of allocating the scarce resources to the production of different possible goods and services, and of distributing the produced goods and services among individuals within the country. Yes, as I told you, the distribution, there will be a problem in the distribution. And it must also decide who gets more and who gets less. Like the best example here, people, those who are consuming the commodity in the public distribution system. So this government has to decide to distribute the produced commodities, whether the poor people are getting consuming the commodity or not, whether they are availing the facility given by the government or not. So the from where the government they will get the commodity, they will consume the commodity from the agricultural farmers. They purchase the consume the commodity from the farmers and they distribute the commodity to the poor people through PDS. Okay, so before consuming the government, they have to decide to whom it has to be, okay, distributed lot or more, and who has to benefit less. Okay, then minimum amount of consumption be ensured for everyone in the society. Yes, so here they have to, the producer has to decide at least a minimum amount of consumption it has to be in a society, then only it lead to the proper living of the people. At least minimum consumption I have to consume. An individual has to consume a minimum amount of consumption, then only minimum level of consumption of the basic needed commodity. Okay, then only the people will live a proper life. Okay, so in that way the producer has to think and they have to produce the commodity. So with this I am finishing for chapter 1. The remaining only one portion is there. I will cover you in the next session. Thank you students for watching my lecture.